There's no question that the new MacBook Pro is an incredible laptop, but can you pay half as much and still get 99% of the performance and benefits? The M1 MacBook Air and the 14-inch MacBook Pros are two of the best laptops that you can get. And at the same time, are you sure you know which one is the better value for you? If you need the absolute best performance of the two, then you already know that that's the 14-inch MacBook Pro. But if you're sort of in between and you need help choosing, let's start out by talking about the display because there are a lot of super important differences there. The MacBook Air comes with a very nice 13.3-inch Retina display and a resolution of 2560 by 1600. This display has worked great for me over the past year. The image quality is very good, the colors are great, and even though it tops out at 400 nits of max brightness, I haven't really found a lot of situations where that has been an issue. If I'm working outside, then of course I want a brighter display, but that's also true for the 14-inch MacBook Pro, which has a maximum brightness of 500 nits for SDR content. So while I do appreciate the additional 100 nits of brightness, that particular advantage isn't as major as it seems, because a 25% increase in nits does not equate to a 25% increase in brightness. And when it comes to HDR content, then the 14-inch MacBook Pro moves further ahead with a sustained brightness of 1000 nits and a peak brightness of 1600 nits. This gives us better dynamic range and more details in the shadows and the highlights, as well as a higher contrast ratio of 1,000,000 to 1. Now, I've been watching more and more HDR content lately, and I really do like the display on the MacBook Pro better. The MacBook Pro also has a higher resolution of 3024 by 1964, and a higher pixel per inch count at 254 versus 227. Now there's absolutely nothing wrong with the MacBook Air display, but looking at them side by side, I would take the MacBook Pro. And on top of that, those are not the only advantages of the 14.2-inch display on the newer MacBook Pro. It's also got a Liquid Retina XDR display and it's powered by mini LEDs. It's the same type of display that we saw in the 12.9-inch M1 iPad Pro and it's absolutely spectacular. The MacBook Pro also has a ProMotion display, which is Apple's adaptive refresh rate of up to 120 hertz. So essentially the display is able to detect in real time what type of content is being viewed in order to offer the best performance. If you're reading or if you're looking at static content, it can slow down the refresh rate down to 24 hertz, then save on battery life. If you're opening apps, if you're scrolling, watching content, or navigating around macOS, then it can choose the optimal refresh rate all the way up to 120 hertz in order to provide a more fluid and responsive user experience. So when it comes down to it, the 14-inch MacBook Pro clearly has the better display. For basic office work, it's not a drastic difference with the exception of the size and resolution. But when you look at these displays side by side, there's no question that the image quality and color accuracy are better on the larger display. So if you're doing photo editing, video editing, want a better viewing experience for content, or just want a larger display with a higher resolution for work, the 14-inch MacBook Pro is the clear winner. And that also brings me to today's sponsor, Monday.com. If you've heard of it before, but you weren't sure what it is, think of Monday.com as a super flexible platform that you can easily customize to help run different aspects of your work. In my case, I can use it to manage everything I do for Tech Gear Talks. So anything from organizing ideas for future videos to actually researching and scripting with Monday Work Docs, creating courses, and then working with different companies, all from right within their platform. You can also use it for project management, marketing, sales and CRM, and even for something like software development. Now, I spent 20 years developing software. I was blown away by how simple the user interface is. And I love the fact that they have templates for pretty much any type of user to help you get started in minutes. This way you don't have to start from scratch, and at the same time, you still have the flexibility to customize it for your needs. I'm also super impressed by automations and how much time they can save you. All you have to do is set a trigger and an action. So for example, when a script is marked as done, move the video to the ready to shoot section. Click on the link in the description to check it out and get one free month. And again, thank you to Monday.com for sponsoring this video. Now back to the MacBooks, the display advantages of the MacBook Pro aren't free. They come at a cost and not just a monetary one. The downside of the larger display and some of the additional features that I'm going to talk about in a minute is the larger form factor. I wouldn't call the 14-inch MacBook Pro a huge laptop, but the MacBook Air is smaller, it's thinner, and lighter. So if portability is a priority for you, it absolutely has the edge. I also like that the MacBook Air is thinner in the front than in the back, so the keyboard has a very slight forward tilt to it. It's a bit more comfortable to type on. On the other hand, one of the advantages of the larger form factor on the 14-inch MacBook Pro is the ports. So the MacBook Air has two Thunderbolt 3 ports on the left and a headphone jack on the right. And there are three concerns that I want to focus on here. So first, there are only two ports. Second, they are both the same type of port. And then third, they're both on the same side. So starting with number one, we're only getting two ports and one of them has to be used for charging, which means that without a hub, you're only left with one open port. For the vast majority of the target audience, this isn't likely to be a real issue. Most casual users don't need an SD card reader, they aren't using external SSDs, they don't plug their laptop into additional displays, and if they do need an accessory, the one port would work for them. Now moving on to number two, we're only getting Thunderbolt 3 ports, which requires you to use an adapter or a hub if you have accessories that use a USB-A port. And that brings me to number three, which is that both ports are on the left side. That means that if your power source is on the right, you have to wrap your cable all the way around. If you use something like a wired mouse, again, you have to plug it in on the left and then wrap it all the way around. And the 14-inch MacBook Pro takes care of most of these concerns. So first, we have three more powerful Thunderbolt 4 ports, two on the left and one on the right. The right side also houses a headphone jack, an HDMI port, and an SD card slot. So you're much less likely to need a hub and you can connect accessories from both sides. You would still need an adapter if you have a USB-A accessory, and I use these super inexpensive ones that I got from Amazon. And finally, on the left, we're also getting a MagSafe 3 port. So we're able to get super fast charging and we have protection against an accidental pull on the cable. Also, since you can use the Thunderbolt ports to charge the MacBook Pro, you can now charge it from both sides. For my MacBook Air, I got one of these Hitachi hubs, which adds USB-A ports and an HDMI port. But with my MacBook Pro, I haven't really had a need for any type of hub. Now, one specific accessory that I want to mention is an external display. The MacBook Air supports a single external 60 Hz 6K display, which again is going to be plenty for the type of user that Apple is targeting. If you need more than that and you don't want to use any type of splitter and additional drivers, then the 14-inch MacBook Pro can do a lot more. If you're getting the M1 Pro chip, you can attach two 60 Hz 6K external displays. And if you upgrade to the M1 Max, you can connect three 60 Hz 6K external displays and one 60 Hz 4K display. So you can see that it really comes down to your needs. If a single large display is enough, even an ultra wide, then the MacBook Air is perfectly fine. But if you want a multi-external display monitor setup, then the 14-inch MacBook Pro is definitely the way to go. Now moving on to the keyboard and trackpad, the differences are subtle, but they're there. So as far as the feel of the keys themselves, or rather the switches, they're the same. These are the best keyboards that I've used on any laptop so far. The keys have a good amount of bounce, they don't require a ton of force, and they're really comfortable to type on for hours. I just got back from a trip where I used this keyboard for 5 days straight to do everything from replying to comments, research for videos, typing up and editing documents, email, and I have zero complaints about these boards. Now the first difference that you'll notice is aesthetic, where the MacBook Pro has a black anodized aluminum well versus silver on the MacBook Air. Next, you'll see that the MacBook Pro has a row of full-size function keys, whereas the MacBook Air has smaller function keys. And this leads right to the last difference, which is the larger Touch ID button on the MacBook Pro. If we look at the trackpads, the only difference is that the MacBook Pro has a slightly larger trackpad, which hasn't really made a functional difference in how I use it. As far as the quality of the trackpads, it's the same, and these are absolutely the best trackpads that I've used on any laptop. When we look at the two cameras, the new one on the MacBook Pro is 1080p instead of 720p on the MacBook Air. It's also better in low light, so the image is going to look less grainy. Now, does this make a meaningful enough difference for video calls? I guess that depends on how good you need it to be. I mean, the image quality is better, and here's a quick sample of the camera and microphone. Here's a camera and microphone sample from the 14-inch MacBook Pro and the 13-inch M1 MacBook Air. This should give you a pretty good idea of the type of image quality
and audio quality that you should expect from both of these laptops.
When we move on to speakers, we see that the MacBook Pro comes out ahead. The MacBook Air actually has really good speakers, but they fall short of the newer 6-speaker system on the MacBook Pro. Now, personally, I don't really use the speakers on my laptops very often, so this isn't a huge deal, but if you do, you will find that the MacBook Pro speakers have more presence and they sound warmer. Now, when it comes to processing power, it's no surprise that the MacBook Pro comes out ahead. Both the M1 and the base M1 Pro have an 8-core CPU, but the M1 chip comes with 4 high-performance cores and 4 high-efficiency cores, and the M1 Pro chip has 6 high-performance cores and 2 high-efficiency cores. So the MacBook Pro should outperform the MacBook Air for multi-core performance, and indeed it does. For single-core performance, the two are pretty much even at 1753 versus 1744. But when we move on to multi-core performance, the MacBook Pro is ahead by about 29% at 9914 versus 7669. In addition to this initial advantage, the MacBook Pro also has an active cooling system which includes 2 fans. That means that as both systems are pushed to 100%, the MacBook Air will heat up and eventually will have to throttle back performance, whereas the MacBook Pro will turn the fans on, remain cool, and it will be able to sustain its already higher performance. And in fact, I ran a test where I pushed the MacBook Pro to 100% CPU usage for 30 minutes straight, and the level of performance never dropped. And I really want to stress the point that this will matter to very specific users. So, for example, you can edit 4K video on the MacBook Air using Final Cut Pro and it'll work well. But if you start adding multiple tracks and effects and adjustment layers and motion graphics, then you'll definitely notice it start to slow down, whereas the MacBook Pro will just continue to crush it. When we look at the GPU, the M1 on the MacBook Air comes with either 7 or 8 GPU cores, whereas the M1 Pro starts out with a 14-core GPU. And the M1 Pro can be upgraded to a 10-core CPU and a 16-core GPU, and then all the way up to a 32-core GPU with the M1 Max. Now, I don't want to spend any more time on performance because we already know that if you need that additional performance, the MacBook Pro is the way to go. But I do my best to read all of your comments, so if you have any questions about your specific use case, just put them in the comment section. Now, one type of performance that I do want to discuss is battery life, and this is where the MacBook Air really shines. So even with a smaller battery, 49.9 watt hour versus 70 watt hour, the MacBook Air has noticeably longer battery life. For Apple TV movie playback, the difference isn't major, 18 hours for the MacBook Air versus 17 hours for the MacBook Pro. But when we move to something else, like even wireless web browsing, then the MacBook Air is rated for 36% better battery life at 15 hours versus 11. And I can tell you from actual use that I absolutely noticed that I have to charge the MacBook Pro more than I need to charge the MacBook Air for similar tasks. And I have a more detailed video about this coming soon. All right, so now let's break down the configuration options and then we'll get to my recommendations. The MacBook Air starts at $999 and the base 14-inch M1 Pro MacBook Pro is $1,999. So that's twice the cost. Now I'm using the Apple Store prices because they're standardized, but you can get better prices by using the links in the description. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that the MacBook Air comes with 8 GB of unified memory and 256 gigs of SSD storage, whereas the MacBook Pro starts with 16 gigabytes of unified memory and a 512 gigabyte SSD. So technically, if you wanted to compare apples to apples, you would need to add $400 to the MacBook Air, which would bring the price difference down to $600 or $550 if you opted for the 8-core GPU on the Air. From a performance standpoint, the MacBook Air is more than enough for the overwhelming majority of users. I've said this before, but if you don't know that you need a MacBook Pro, you don't need a MacBook Pro. But if you do need that higher performance, the better display, the additional ports, and you want a better camera and speakers to go along with that, you will absolutely love the 14-inch MacBook Pro. Now, do I see any reasons why the casual user who wants macOS would still spend an additional $600 to get the 14-inch MacBook Pro? Yes, but only in rare cases where you prioritize convenience and luxury over value. So for example, if you wanted ports on both sides, if you wanted to be able to use an SD card reader every once in a while without having to bring one along, and if you wanted a larger and better display and better speakers because you watch a lot of content on your laptop and you plan on keeping it for a long time, then I can see someone who has some disposable income saying, if I keep this laptop for 6 years, it comes out to an extra $100 per year. Now you should find out how the 14-inch MacBook Pro compares to the 13-inch M1 MacBook Pro click on my face to subscribe. Hopefully this video was helpful. You know what I always say, buy it nice or buy it twice. Good luck and see you soon.